multinomial. So these three random variables jointly have a multinomial distribution. So n equals 10, 10 trials, just like a binomial situation. But now we have three probabilities. 1/2 for blue, third for white, and a sixth for black. Are Y1, Y2, and Y3 independent or not? Correct, they are not. Think about it like this. You have a fixed number of trials, 10. Suppose before the experiment began, someone with psychic power said that Y1 is going to equal 10. Say, give you any information about Y2 and Y3? Definitely. You would know that then those numbers have to be zero. So these are definitely dependent on each other. And if you look at definitions 5.11 and 5.12, you'll see a probability definition 5.12 that looks a heck of a lot like a binomial probability. The difference now is instead of a choosing symbol, we have a multinomial coefficient. And remember, sometimes called the choosing symbol, the binomial coefficient. What I'm about to write down is the multinomial coefficient. So if we want the probability of 6-2-2, six blues, two whites, three blacks. Let me leave a space here just for a moment. Go back to it. Probability of blue is 1/2. That happens 6 times. Probability of white is 1/3. That would happen twice. Probability of black is 1/6. That would happen twice. Now, if I were to leave my answer like this, that would be the probability of 6 blues, 2 whites, 2 blacks in that specific order. What we need to do is consider all the different orders they can arrive in. That's what the multinomial coefficient counts for us. So 10 factorial over 6 factorial, 2 factorial, 2 factorial. So 10 factorial, different ways to arrange the arrival of the 10 balls. Divide by 6 factorial because the 6 blue balls would be indistinguishable from each other, and so on. So 35 over 576 is our exact answer. 0.0608 is our approximate answer. So it's really just an extension of the binomial distribution idea. Next story. A new math course. It is developed at college. Percent of students who would earn a certain grade in the course is given here. So suppose you randomly select students, force them to take this new math course. In the long run, about 10% of them are going to get an A, 30% Bs, and so on. Suppose specifically 50 students are selected at random. you read definition 5.11, you have rules for the multinomial experiment, which should remind you of the rules you go through when you learn about the binomial random variable. For example, number of trials is fixed. That should remind you of binomial. And rule number 4 here says the trials are independent of each other. That means if we randomly select one student to be in the class, that it doesn't make any other student any more or less likely to be randomly selected. And if a student, that student gets an A, that doesn't make the next student any more or less likely to get any certain grade. So what we'd have to do in this story is cheat a little bit and pretend that we're selecting these students from a population that's so large enough that it's really close to a with replacement kind of situation, which obviously wouldn't work in real life. You're not going to select the same student twice. But let's not worry about that right now. So this time we're going to have 5 random variables for the number of students who get these specific grades. So just like in the last example, we had 3 variables that were multinomial with n number of trials and specific probabilities. Now we have n as 50 and 5 probabilities. That I'm just going to take from this information right here. Y1 is the number of A's. So P1 is going to be corresponding 10% or 0.1 and so on. Now let's look at theorem 5.13. We're going to compute the expected value of all of these y's and their variances. Now, if you have a good memory, or if you look on the back of the superhandout, you remember that the mean of a binomial random variable is n times p. Does it make sense that we have the same mean this time? Because you figure, in the long run, about 10% of students are going to get A's, and this time we're going to have 50 of them. So we expect about 10% of 50, or about 5, to get A's this time. That's not a guarantee, that's just the expected value. So yeah, all of these expected values are just n times p. The variance. Well, variance of binomial was n times p times 1 minus p. Some people call it n times p times q. If you look at theorem 5.13, we get the same thing again. N times pi times qi. So all these variances are the same as if it was a binomial situation. So right here we have 50 times 0.1 times 0.9, which is 4.5, and so on. Review question. Test whether or not you have reviewed your notes since Tuesday. If two variables are independent, then their covariance must be
zero.
Right? These variables are not independent, so it won't surprise us if they have covariances that aren't zero, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Would anyone, if you haven't looked at the super handle yet, it's kind of a spoiler on the super handle, would anyone like to guess if the covariance between any particular pair of these random variables will be positive or negative? Do you think as one of those variables gets bigger, do you think the others will also tend to get bigger or smaller?
Smaller.
Right? Because the more A's you see among these 50 people, you typically would expect fewer B's or D's or whatever. So we are expecting negative covariances. And sure enough, here's the new part. Here's what is different from a binomial distribution. Theorem 5.13, part 2, it says the covariance is negative n times ps times pt. If s is not equal to t, of course. So we have a bunch of covariances to find. On a big table. And if you've taken linear algebra, you might call what we're about to draw a diagonal matrix.
Yeah. No, literally favorite math class I've ever taken.
So I'm only drawing half of this matrix. In this box, we're going to write the covariance between y1 and y2. So do we only have to draw half the matrix?
It's
symmetrical.
Right, because the covariance would be the same between y2 and y1 over here. So our first covariance between y1 and y2, we have, I'm copying just what I see up here. What is n? 50. And the probabilities for y1 and y2 are 0.1 and 0.3. And we get negative 1.5. Any questions about how that works? Because I'm just going to write the rest of them in right now.
Why was that negative again?
Like the theory behind why it's negative?
If
two variables have a relationship where as one gets bigger, the other one is more likely to be smaller, that should remind you of, in regression, of a negative correlation between two variables. Very similar idea here, basically the same idea. Then you would expect a negative covariance. And if you have 50 students taking a class, the more students that get X, typically, that means you would expect in the long run fewer D's, fewer C's, or whatever. Because one of these variables gets bigger, you expect the others to be smaller. because they all have to add up to 50 at the end of the day. Now, here are the rest of the numbers on the table. You can double check me later if you feel like it.
He's the guru, he can't be wrong.
I have been wrong on the board. I do have a lot of confidence in my notes, however. So first couple times I taught this class, I had some genius students who found out my mistakes.
Well, do you use the same notes? Like next time you teach us, will you use the same notes?
Yeah.
So once you make them once.
Yeah, that's the idea. You just gotta fight to them. Never have to do it again. Bonus question. So we've already agreed with each other that this matrix would be symmetric if we filled in all the spots. But what we haven't talked about yet is the main diagonal. Wouldn't these be covariances of a variable with itself? Yes. Would anyone like to guess what a covariance of a variable with itself equals?
The variance?
Yes, and I'm going to convince you of that very quickly. Last time we talked about different ways of finding the covariance, and the computational way of finding it would be to find the expected value of their product minus the product of their individual expected values. And instead of writing the expected value of x times x, don't we usually just write that as x squared? And then we can write this as the expected value of x quantity squared. What is this?
So you're doing that.
Isn't this just the variance by definition? And those of you who are taking regression, what is the correlation of a variable with itself?
One.
It must always be one. Last time we talked about the population correlation. So the correlation of a variable with itself would be the covariance of the variable with itself, which we just agreed is this.
Boom.
Okay, now we're going to define a new random variable for this problem. We're still talking about these students in this class. Let's have a variable called W, which is the class GPA. So if every single student got an A in the course, the class GPA would be 4. And if every single student failed the course, it would be 0.
That'd be an awful class.
So here's how the computation would work. At the end of the semester, the professor would say, okay, I'm going to multiply all the A's by 4, all the B's by 3. Let's pretend that they just have A's, B's, and C's at this school instead of A, B's, and so forth. Multiplying y5 by 0, don't need to worry about that, and then divide by 50. And here is a hint that I gave you last time regarding one of your homework problems. You're about to do computations with the random variable w. You probably want to write it so that each individual variable has its own coefficient in front of it. So for example, you have 4 over 50 times y1, and so on. Last time we used theorem 5.12 quite a bit. Now we're going to do it again today. Expected value of W This is going to be the easier of our two questions. So hopefully you're comfortable now with this idea. The expected value of a linear combination of random variables, you can just split up the random variables and their coefficients. So we have 4 over 50 times the expected value of y1, which is 5. Three over 50 times 15, and so on. Final answer, 2.2.
Oh, geez.
So, if you randomly select these students, the class GPA might be greater than or less than 2.2, but in the long run, the professor taught this course many times, that would be very close to the average GPA he would observe. Now, the variance, this one's going to take more work, and I think this is worth practicing again. The last time we tried this, not everybody got the same answer, so just again, look at theorem 512. Part A is the easy part. We just did that together. Variance. You have squares of coefficients times the individual variances plus 2 times all the different possible combinations of coefficients times the covariance. Right now we have 5 variables. Or 5 variables to start with. But the nice thing is, in this W variable, there's 4 variables. So we only have to think about 4 choose 2 instead of 5 choose 2 combinations. What's 4 choose 2?
6,
correct. So we'll get to that part in a minute. Let's do the beginning part first. So, 4 over 50 squared times the variance of y1. What's the variance of y1? 4.5. If you're going to look back at these notes later and wonder where these numbers came from, let me do this. This is the expected value of y1. This is the variance of y1. Right, so we have 3 more of these. First part of this variance of a linear combination. Now the tricky part, 2 times all the possible combinations of coefficients times the covariance. And we already know there's 6 of them, right? So let me do this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You ever get in trouble at school and your teacher made you write sentences?
Yes. You did?
Well, our entire class had to.
Yeah, it's kind of what we're doing here. We're just setting things up.
We're getting punishment.
This whole course is punishment.
Yeah.
Oh, it sums it up. Wow.
So, what are going to go in here are these coefficients, 4 over 50, 3 over 50, and so on. So let's try the first one. The y1, y2 combo. 4 50 over 50, 3 over 50. And we're not done. We need to multiply that by the covariance between y1 and y2, which we found over here, would be negative 1.5.
Real talk for a second. Is this the last day for stuff for exam Thursday? Because, are you going to give us a question like this on the exam Thursday? Where we spend the whole time writing?
No, one thing I have learned, teaching this course a few times now, is that if I gave you a problem like this, it would take up like half my exam time. So if I did want to give you something like this to do, that'd be like on the take-home problem.
Okay.
Yeah, the be happy you didn't weren't in this class the first time I taught it, because I accidentally gave exams that were too long.
Would you care about that?
No, I did my typical Mr. Nice Guy thing, and I think what I did, maybe at the end of class I said something like, well, if you're not, nobody has started problem five yet, you can do that at home too. Mm-hmm. Stuff like that. You know, I'm a big pushover.
We appreciate that.
Y1, Y2, and see, Y5 wasn't included in W, so we actually don't have to worry about any pairs or covariances that are in this bottom row. So the six covariances we are going to use are the ones in these six boxes. Does that make sense? Here's the next one. 4 over 50 here, 2 over 50 here, negative 2. What pair was that?
Y1 and
Y3. Yeah, that was Y1 and Y3. Let me just write the rest of them up here. Try to have these go in not random order. I think this was Y1 and Y3.
Yeah.
This was Y1 and Y4. Keep an eye on you, make sure I'm telling you the truth.
You are.
Y2, Y3 is next.
Yeah.
Y2, Y4.
That's the entire answer.
Yes, the variance of W is everything I'm circling in red. So the standard deviation of W is just the square root of that. And here's a hint for next Thursday's exam. I'm going to ask you to find a Chebyshev interval.
That's
the
valid answer.
Yeah. So let's practice a Chebyshev interval.
That's what we have to practice.
Then you got to practice spelling it, please.
Yeah. First question on the exam.
How do you spell?
Oral exam question. Spell Chebyshev by the spelling bee.
That's the reason I was never picked for those.
But although I should warn you, Chebyshev is spelled differently in different textbooks.
Of course.
So no one really knows.
Yes, no one really knows who this guy is.
The name of him.
Probably get tired of spelling it for people, so he's like, yeah, you're right. That's why I do people say my name wrong. So.
I tell people spell it however they want.
Right. you're gonna have to do this on your own next Thursday, so...
This is that a problem?
No. Do you know where on the super handout you would find Chebyshev's theorem? Chapter 3, it's theorem what point what?
It was at 3.1.
3.14, yes. Really?
Yes.
Yeah, so if you forget, just remember...
Just have to be.
It's just the middle of the exam, that's what it's...
No, that's like the coolest thing ever.
We promise. Now, Chebyshev's rule is described in two different ways, and we always talk about this first method right here, and I'll write the generic form of it on the board first. Quarters. That means the 1 minus 1 over k squared, that is 3 quarters. So if that equals 3 quarters, hopefully you're good at this, your math majors. Can you tell me what k must equal then?
1 over k squared equals 1 fourth.
So k would equal?
The square root of 1/4.
Which is?
I don't know.
You got this.
I gave you guys 90% of the work, you did the rest.
Then got it. A equals 2. Yep. So now let's replace the generic stuff with specific values. In this problem, we have a random variable called W. Yeah, so value W minus its expected value would be less than 2 times its standard deviation. This probability. And before class, Brandon, you were telling me about students needing to interpret something.
Mm-hmm.
Like interpret the result.
Yeah.
It's always kind of a vague and annoying question because you're never sure exactly what it means. How would you interpret this interval? What is this really saying? This is saying that the probability that the random variable we observe will be within 2 standard deviations of its mean, that probability is at least 3/4. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Some more specific information here. 2.2 for the expected value. Square root of 0.0232 for the standard deviation. 3/4 right here. And at this point on your homework, I noticed some of you are doing different things at this stage. Let me make it simple for you. Suppose there's a number out there called A. The absolute value of A is less than 10. What does that tell you about the number A?
It's greater than negative 10.
It's greater than negative 10 and less than 10. Y'all got that?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's all we're doing. We're taking that idea and applying it to this. So therefore, negative 2 times the square root must be less than W minus 2.2. The absolute value signs are gone now. And that must be less than positive 2 times that square root. Now all you have to do is multiply all three of these numbers. Not multiply, excuse me. Add 2.2 to all three of these numbers. Abstract. computations. These endpoints. So if I ask you for a Chebyshev interval, your last line of work looks something like this.
Do you want us to? Can we leave it as like the one above it?
I'd rather you actually find the prime answer.
Okay.
Any questions on Andy so far? We have one more thing to talk about in this chapter. Theorems 5.14. And 5.15. And this has to do with having a parameter of a random variable also be a random variable. So for example, pick your favorite random variable. Let's say it's normal. Normal, as you know, has two parameters, mu and sigma. Well, what if somebody said mu? That's going to be a random variable too. So here's how we're going to handle that. And we're going to start with a story. At every home basketball game, fans are chosen at halftime. Each fan attempts one three-point shot. Successful, they win a new car. What?
What?
What? This is a true story, too.
No.
Is there like a 60-pound ball?
Is it like 5-year-olds and younger are chosen? Or what?
I'm looking for a butt.
Yeah.
But,
just relax, we're learning math.
Alright.
Soon. 50 miles.
Probability of success by any fan independently, of course. Number of cards given away at a game. So what does this have to do with what I was just saying about the parameter of a random variable also being a random variable? Well, suppose n is going to be a random variable too. Now, once n is determined, then what kind of random variable are we talking about? If n was fixed, let's say, what kind of random variable would y be? Correct. Now, let's say n is a random variable, not a famous one. Let's just say it has this PMF. So let's say somebody has a four-sided die. They roll it, let's say they roll a three, and they say, okay, randomly choose three basketball fans, have them come down to court, they'll all attempt a three-point shot, and if they make it, they win a car. So in that situation, they could potentially give away up to three cars. And what we would like is the expected value of n to start with. And its variance, because we're going to need that Now, on this board, we're only talking about the random variable n. We reviewed this. You learned this in the previous course. We reviewed this, I think, the second week of class. It's just a little discrete random variable with column PDF. So the expected value of n is the product, sum of the products of possible values and probabilities. Here, 1.25 here. Now, as Trevor pointed out, once n is determined, y, the number of cars that are given away, that's binomial. With n trials and probability of success, 0.1. If you look at these theorems, 514 and 515, tells you how to find the expected value and variance of a random variable that's determined by another random variable. And as usual, the expected value is a little easier to work with than the variance. But before we jump into that, actually, what we should do is just remember facts about the binomial. Expected value of y given n is n times p, or 0.1 times n. Variance of y given n, npq, n times 0.1 times 0.9, or 0.09n. Okay, now let's look at the thing. Expected value of y equals the expected value of the expected value of y given n. That might sound weird, but that is just following the instructions of theorem 5.14. See right here? It says expected value of y1 equals the expected value of the expected value of y1 given y2. Well, what's the expected value of y given n? We just found it.
Right here.
0.1 times n. Point 0.1 is a constant, which we can remove. Expected value of n, we found a moment ago, 2.5. 0.25. So that probably makes perfect sense to you, because you're thinking, in the long run, we're going to randomly select about 2.5 people to attempt a three-pointer, and 10% of them, in the long run, are going to be successful. 10% of 2.5 is 0.25. So suppose that you're the statistician and the CEO of the basketball team hired you to figure this out. Like, how many cars am I going to have to give away? Well, you can say, well, on average, you're going to give away 0.25 cars per game. He's not going to understand that. So what might you say?
Every four games, you give away on average one car?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Good. Unless you get lucky, four games, four cars. One game, four cars.
Well, actually, what your comment kind of brings up our next question. What if fans get lucky this season, how many cards might I have to give away if they get lucky and I get unlucky? That's when you start thinking of the variance of random variable, right? So now let's think about the variance of Y. And if you look at the next theorem, you'll see this. This is split into two pieces. It's the expected value of the variance of Y given N plus the variance of the expected value of Y given N. What's the variance of Y given N? We found it right here. 0.9 times N. What is the expected value of Y given N? We just worked with it. 0.1 times N. We want the variance of that. So, first part, take out the 0.09. If I take out the 0.1 from this variance, what happens? Expected value of N from up there is 2.5. Variance of N from up there is 1.25. Our variance, 0.2375. Here's the bonus question. I'll get you started on it, and I'll let you finish it on your own later, and then you can look at my notes later. It's going to be another Chebyshev interval, so let's not go through all the details together. But we're still talking to the CEO or the owner of the basketball team, and he's grumpy about potentially giving away a bunch of cars. And he said, okay, the variance is 0.2375. I don't know what that means. Give me a range of the number of cars I might have to give away this season. And how many home games are there? Well, suppose there's 40.
You're welcome, guys.
Can you put on her exam? Just choose.
When I had the genius students in my class the first time I taught this.
Wait. So what are we then?
I didn't say you're not geniuses. They would ask all these crazy questions, and I said, that's a great question. I think I'll put it on next to you.
And did they like that answer? Because I didn't.
So you're a genius.
No, I'm not.
That's the reason why I keep a lot of my questions to myself.
Would you say you keep a lot of your questions to yourself?
Yeah.
One question they asked did inspire one of the questions that wound up on the final.
Is please don't put Ben's question on the final.
There's no more questions. We're good.
Yeah.
We got one question. He's motivated us to never ask questions.
Good way to do it.
Okay, 40 games a year, finding Chebyshev interval with the number of cars given away per year lands in the interval of probability at least 8/9. Now, hopefully, you can find a Chebyshev interval with that probability no problem. If you have the expected value and the standard deviation. The catch here is that we're talking about the total of cars given away over 40 games. So I need to give you a little bit of a head start. You have to create a new random variable here. It's called X. Cars given away per year. And figuring out facts about X will give us the opportunity to review a couple things. So once again, what is Y? Y is the number of cars given away at a game. And if N is determined just by someone rolling a four-sided die, and the probability of someone making a three-pointer is independently always 0.1, should repeated observations of Y be independent of each other? Yeah, that's going to help us out. So wouldn't X just be the sum of 40 IID Ys? Yeah, so let me write it like this. Let's call the Ys Y1 for game number 1, Y2 for game number 2, and so on. So Y1 through Y40. What's the expected value of X? Well, wouldn't it just be 40 times the expected value of Y? So we can tell the owner of the team, gonna have to give away, on average, about 10 cars per year. Then he asks the question about, well, what if the fans are lucky this year? Give me an interval. He's asking for the Chebyshev interval. Variance. Thanks to independence, all we have to do to get the variance is, can you tell me? Squared. Let me write it up. What we're trying to find here is the variance of Y1 plus Y2 all the way up to Y40. This is what we're going to write right here.
So adding up all the individual variance,
right? So it's going to be 40 times the variance of Y, which is 0.32375, which is 9.5. And thanks to independence, we don't have a bunch 40 choose 2 more terms that would each involve a covariance. That's why we like it when variables are dependent. And then you'll need the standard deviation for your Chebyshev interval. Would you like me to tell you what the final correct interval is, or do you want no spoilers and check it on my notes later?
I'm cool with
the
spoiler.
Yeah. Sure.
You don't mind the spoiler?
Sure.
Okay.
Spoiler.
Final interval. So pretend you're talking to the team owner who's never taken a stat course. And you want to give this information to him in a way that he'll actually understand. What would you say? What specific words would you say to him?
You know, it's about those cards.
Given here, you can give anywhere from, what is it, you are not about zero? 0 to 20 cards?
Well, the zero is not in this interval.
That's zero.
Impossible.
One, is it one?
Yeah, number of cards you're gonna give away has to be an integer. What are the integers in this interval, 1 to 19?
Zero up or down?
Well, we don't need to round anything. Right now we're just asking ourselves which integers are in this interval.
Oh, okay, I get it.
So here's what here's how I would say it to the guy. Since he's never taken a stat course, this is about 90%, right? So I would tell him, in about 90% of the basketball seasons in the long run, the number of cars you give away is going to be somewhere between 1 and 19 cars. And one thing we learned about Chebyshev is that if we found the actual probability, it would probably be significantly greater. So you could almost promise him, if you're willing to be a risk taker, you could promise him, well, you're not probably never going to have to give away more than 20 cars a season. Yeah, then if it actually happens,
it's like, well, you're
an
anomaly. Sorry.
Just got really unluckiness to
it. I really.
All right, let's do one more problem, then we can talk homework or whatever.
Or whatever.
Yeah.
I don't understand why the exact value of y given equals 0.1 times.
Okay. Y, the number of cars given away in a game, that is a binomial random variable. Because, let's say that N, the number of fans that are chosen, let's say that's chosen to be a number like 3 or 4, something like that. Once that number is chosen, the number of cards we give away is binomial because you can think of each fan as a trial, as an attempt to sink the three-pointer. It's either a success or a failure. So that's a binomial random variable. And the mean of binomial is N times P. So NP is 0.1. So this is the P, and then N, this is just a generic value for N that we put right here.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
so would X also be a binomial variable then?
No, it would be the sum of binomials.
Okay.
Which is not binomial.
So if hypothetically you didn't want a Chebyshev interval, you wanted an exact value, how would you go about finding it?
It would be tough. It might be extremely tedious to deal with just paper and pencil. In real life, if I wanted to know that exact probability, I would probably sit down in Mathematica and just start playing with this stuff until I figured out what to do. It may or may not be easy. I haven't actually thought about it.
No questions.
No.
No more questions.
Yeah, be careful what questions you ask. They might wind up on the same. Any other questions? Yeah, when we get into more sophisticated and newer material, stuff you've definitely never seen before, we can get into some really cool ideas and crazy questions, deep thoughts about statistics. Okay, last problem of the day. And there'll be one more we don't get to, which you can read in the notes later. So the one's going to be short and lovely. Let's say y is uniform from 0 to theta. And let's review uniform for a moment. Look on the back of the super handout. What would be the expected value of y given theta? In other words, I'm just asking you, what's the expected value of that random variable in terms of theta? Right, you probably didn't even have to look at the super handout for that one, right? Because you probably remember the mean of uniform is just the average of the endpoints. Now, the variance, on the other hand, what's that? Yeah, it's the difference in the endpoints squared divided by 12. And in this case, obviously, the difference is theta, so theta squared over 12. Suppose somebody said, wait, hold on, before you observe that uniform random variable from 0 to theta, first, theta will be determined. That's a random variable too. And it's exponential with parameter beta. And if you have a good memory, or if you look on the super handout, just expected value of theta is beta, its variance is beta squared. And you might need to know this too. Expected value of theta squared. I should make you tell me. Remember, the variance equals expected value of theta squared minus expected value of theta quantity squared. And if this is beta squared and this is beta inside that bracket, then what do we have here? So you do the easy one. You tell me what the expected value of y is. Beta over 2 is correct. And finally, variance of y. Once again, just using the formula from that theorem. We need the variance of y given theta. Ben told us that. That was theta squared over 12. And right here, we want the variance and the expected value of y given theta. That will stay over 2. Here we can remove the 1/12 from the expected value. We can remove the 1/2 from this variance, which gets squared, so 1/4. You just told me the expected value of theta squared is 2 beta squared. Variance of theta. Answer. 5 + 8 squared. Brendan.
That's it.
Charles. Thank you.